We're finally nearing the end of our 4L60E rebuild, and in this episode, we'll tackle the last remaining piece of the puzzle, the valve body. The first thing we'll do is test the resistance of all of the solenoids. As long as this reads close to spec, the solenoids should at least be electronically functioning. But they can still have mechanical issues like a stuck plunger, so this doesn't guarantee that they're working. Since they're not too expensive, some people choose to replace all of the electronic parts during a rebuild. Each of these solenoids is a two-wire connector, so it's easy to test for resistance across those two terminals. So now that we've checked them all, and they're all within spec, we'll move on to disassembly. The first thing we'll do is remove the bolt holding in the pressure control solenoid retainer. Then we can gently remove the pressure control solenoid. As parts come out, it's a good idea to lay them down on the bench in a relative approximation of their location in the valve body. Some of the valves look similar, but you definitely don't want to mix any of them up or put springs in the wrong locations. The next thing we'll do is remove the manual valve. This can simply be slid out of its bore. And now we'll start removing all of the various parts that make up this assembly. And now we'll remove the first of many retaining clips that's holding in a bore plug. We'll get an up-close look at the removal of these clips in just a minute. There are plenty of them to remove. There are special tools for the job, but a small flat blade screwdriver will work just fine. The clips that are holding valves in will face the sealing surface, but the ones holding solenoids in place will face the transmission pan, such as this one holding in the torque converter clutch PWM solenoid. And with that clip removed, we can carefully remove the solenoid. And with that set aside, we'll remove the retaining clip holding in the bore plug that was behind the pressure control solenoid. And with the clip out of the way, we can manipulate the valve and spring to help push the bore plug out of the bore. These steel tools could easily scratch valves or sealing surfaces, so great care must be taken to do no harm. And with a little more work, we can remove the spring, and then give the whole thing a few taps to help remove the actuator feed limit valve. We'll put that aside and continue removing the valve components that we removed that first clip from. First, we have a bore plug. Then we'll give it a few more taps until the regulator apply valve and spring drop out of the bore. Then, after a little more work, we can remove the isolator valve. Then there's another clip and another bore plug. This one was a little bit stuck, but a little bit of careful twisting with pliers got it out no problem. Then we can pull out the 3-4 relay valve and the 4-3 sequence valve and its spring. Then we'll move on over to the other side and remove the three bolts holding on the forward accumulator cover. We'll apply pressure against the cover as the bolts are removed because there are springs pressing against it. And with those bolts out of the way, we can remove the cover. And then we'll remove the forward accumulator spring, the forward accumulator pin, and the forward accumulator piston. The piston can be wiggled out of the bore using the accumulator pin, or by simply grabbing the outside edge of where the pin rides with pliers and twisting the piston out. Then, also from under that cover, we can remove the low overrun valve and spring. Then we need to remove the spring pin that's holding in the bore plug for the forward abuse valve. To do this, we'll push against the bore plug just a little bit to relieve the spring tension and use a pin punch on the other side of the valve body to easily push out the pin. Then, still compressing the valve spring, we can remove the spring pin by hand. And then out comes the bore plug, the spring, and the forward abuse valve. Then we'll remove another retaining clip holding in the 1-2 shift solenoid. Once that pops out, we can remove the 1-2 shift valve and spring. Then there's the retaining clip on the 2-3 shift solenoid. Here's a close-up of how these clips can be removed with a flathead screwdriver. And with the clip removed, we can separate the solenoid from the valve body and remove the 2-3 shuttle valve as well as the 2-3 shift valve. Then we'll move back to the other side of the valve body. Here's a close-up look at removing the retaining clips on the sealing surface side. And with that clip removed, we can wiggle out the sticking bore plug, set it aside, pull out the 3-4 shift valve spring, and then, by pushing it out, remove the 3-4 shift valve. Then we'll pop out another retaining clip and another bore plug to remove the 3-2 downshift spring and valve. And next up is the 3-2 control solenoid. Like the other solenoids, this is held in by a retaining clip on the oil pan side. As shown here, an alternative way to push these clips out is by pushing on each leg of the clip with a screwdriver and pushing it straight through the valve body. Then the solenoid can be removed, as well as the 3-2 control valve and spring. Next up, there's another spring clip to remove that's holding in the reverse abuse valve. We'll remove this one the same way by compressing the valve spring, pushing the pin out, and then, once it's removed, out comes the bore plug, the reverse abuse spring, and valve. Back on the other side of the valve body, we need to remove the 1-2 accumulator valve sleeve. This spring pin can be removed by pushing in the valve sleeve and pushing down against the pin with the same flathead screwdriver. And after the pin is removed, we can release the spring pressure. Then out comes the 1-2 accumulator valve sleeve and spring with the 1-2 accumulator valve inside of it. And that's it. That's the entire valve body disassembled. Here we have all of the parts laid out. You can imagine why it's a good idea to lay out the valves like this so that you can be confident everything is in the right place as the valve body is reassembled. Now is the time to clean up the valve body as well as possible. This one was sprayed down thoroughly with brake cleaner. There are a lot of sharp edges, so a solvent spray with a good amount of pressure behind it is the safest way to get all the bores and passages clean without the possibility of introducing foreign materials. Other than the solenoid screens and O-rings, we won't be replacing any parts in the valve body. That is, except for this single spring, the 3-2 control valve spring that came in the rebuild kit. In some models of 4L60E, the spring would experience fatigue, so it's generally a good idea to replace them. Most of the solenoids have O-ring seals, so they'll get cleaned up and replaced. Here we have the torque converter clutch solenoid. We'll simply use a pick to remove the O-rings from the solenoid assembly. Then we'll use the point of the pick to unclip the filter screen from the solenoid. And with the old filter removed, we can click the new one into place. And then we'll reinstall two new oiled O-rings. We'll repeat this same procedure before installing each of the solenoids. After filming this section of reassembly, I ended up taking the torque converter clutch solenoid back out in order to modify it. In normal operation, what this solenoid is doing is controlling flow from the tip of the solenoid to this passage in between the two O-rings. What we're going to do is remove the O-ring and cut a notch into the solenoid in order to bypass that entirely. But why would we want to do that? This PWM torque converter clutch solenoid was added to the 4L60E in 1995. Previous to that, only the on-off solenoid in the oil pump controlled the torque converter lockup. But GM added this additional PWM solenoid in order to allow for a gradual apply and release of the torque converter clutch. A very common issue in 4L60Es is that the regulator apply bore gets worn, fluid leaks past the valve, and the torque converter clutch doesn't get enough fluid pressure to maintain good lockup. With only 80,000 miles on it, it's unlikely that the regulator valve bore is significantly worn, so I don't really want to go through the process of installing aftermarket parts, most of which require reaming the valve body for an oversized valve. An old school fix is to stake that regulator valve in place, but doing this can overpressurize the torque converter and cause issues. So all we're going to do is use the Dremel to cut a slot past the O-ring on the solenoid to delete the PWM torque converter clutch function from the transmission. This makes the lockup perform more like an older 4L60E or a 700R4, where the torque converter clutch gets more pressure and is either locked or it isn't. I also like it because it gives more feedback to the driver, and it's easy to tell when the torque converter clutch is engaged versus when it's not. But that's enough about that. So now we'll get back to putting the valve body back together. We'll oil up our torque converter clutch solenoid and reinstall it to the valve body. Then we can reinstall the retaining clip simply by pushing it back into place. Then we'll clean up, oil, and then install the isolator valve. With that pushed all the way in, we'll install the regulator apply spring and the regulator apply valve. And then the bore plug is fit back into place and a retaining clip is reinstalled. Next we have the 4-3 sequence valve spring, 4-3 sequence valve, the 3-4 relay valve, and a bore plug and retaining clip. It's a good idea to carefully move the valves within their bores to make sure the springs are in the right place and nothing is bound up. And then in goes the 3-4 shift valve, spring, and another bore plug and retaining clip. Next is the reverse abuse valve and spring, followed by the bore plug, which we can push all the way in once we line things up just right. Then we'll apply pressure to the bore plug and install the spring pin. After that is the 3-2 downshift valve and spring. And finally, the bore plug and retaining clip that caps it off. And next to that goes the 3-2 control spring and valve, and then we'll replace the O-rings and filter screen on the 3-2 control solenoid and install it into the valve body. And of course, pop in the retaining clip that holds it in place. Then we'll move to the other side of the valve body to install the actuator feed limit valve and spring, and then another bore plug, which we'll compress to reinstall the retaining clip. And then we can reinstall the pressure control solenoid. Once that's in place, the retainer slides over it and we'll thread in the bolt that holds it in place. After that, we can reassemble the 1-2 accumulator valve, valve spring, and sleeve, and slide it into the valve body. Then, applying enough pressure to compress the valve spring, we can reinstall the spring pin. Of course, make sure the spring pins are flush or a little bit below flush to the sealing surface. Next up is the 2-3 shift valve, and then the 2-3 shuttle valve. We'll install a new O-ring onto the 2-3 shift solenoid, and then reinstall it into the case. And that's held in by another retaining clip. Then in goes the 1-2 shift valve spring and valve. And the 1-2 shift solenoid gets cleaned up, a new O-ring installed, and then goes in with a retaining clip. Next we have the forward abuse valve and spring, followed by a bore plug, which gets held in place so the spring pin can be reinstalled. Then in goes the low overrun valve and spring. And then we have the forward accumulator piston and its seal. We'll clean it up, remove the old seal, and install a new oiled one. To be honest, I kind of regret not replacing the plastic accumulator pistons with aluminum ones while doing this rebuild. That's a fairly standard practice, as the plastic ones can get cracked and cease to function. Since this transmission isn't all that old and the miles aren't all that high, I'm hoping the plastic ones will be okay. For what it's worth, if these pistons do fail in the future, at least the whole transmission doesn't have to come back out for them to be replaced. So anyway, we'll pop the piston back into its bore and press it down into place. Then we can install the piston pin and make sure it installs all the way into its bore. And on top of that, we'll reinstall the forward accumulator spring. Once that's all in place, we'll carefully align the springs and reinstall the accumulator cover. We'll get all three bolts threaded in to hold it in place until we can tighten them all down evenly. And then the three accumulator cover bolts get torqued down, and we can carefully align the pressure control solenoid retainer with the notch in the solenoid, and once the retainer sits flush with the case, we can torque that down as well. And with that done, the valve body assembly is complete. And one last thing before we start reassembly, we'll change out the seals on the fluid pressure manifold switch. We'll use a pick with a slight curve to carefully lift the seal out of its bore until it can be removed from the switch body. And we'll repeat this for all of the seals. On this seal, the plastic switch membrane came out with it, so we'll separate the two and put them aside and continue removing the seals from the switch body. Sometimes the switch components will come out with the seals, so we'll have to keep track of everything. And now that all the seals are out, we'll remove the remaining switch membranes. They're just a transparent plastic film and can be lifted up from one edge with the point of a pick. Beneath them, three of the switches have metal discs and two have plastic inserts. And once everything has been removed, we'll thoroughly clean the parts. And we'll start reassembling the switch exactly as it came apart. The membranes can be a bit tricky to reinstall. The method that worked best for me was to fold the film a little bit, insert the leading edge, and then unfold it into the case, using the pick to push the last corner underneath the ridge in the body. Then run the pick along the outside edge of the film to make sure it's completely in place. We'll repeat the process until all five switch membranes are reinstalled. Then we'll apply a little bit of oil to each in preparation to install the new seals. Here's a close-up look at the special seals the manifold switch uses. There are two types of seals used in these switches, short and tall. This switch uses the tall seals, so we'll oil and install five new ones. These can be installed basically the same way as the membranes, but it's a little easier since they're a bit more pliable. They're pretty easy to get popped into place, but once they're all in place, you'll want to use a pick to go around the edges and make sure they're all completely installed. This is what the installed set of seals should look like. They should be nice and even, and just a bit above flush with the body of the manifold switch. And just like that, we're at the end of this episode, so we'll be ready to start transmission reassembly in the next one.